number 7. The original Lovaas Young Autism Experiment, has never been replicated, which is just false. The original experiment in which he took a group of children and gave them a prescribed amount of ABA therapy, which was between 25, usually these studies are between 25 and 40 hours a week of ABA therapy with young children. Approximately 50% of them were recovered in the Lovaas experiment, and in all of the replicating studies, it's been the numbers have been very similar. It's just under 50% of the kids fully recover. And why is this important to you? Because it's important to you for a lot of different reasons. You have a child, and you want to be efficient, and you want to be effective. And so for a lot of us, we're concerned about not wasting time. And study after study has shown that ABA is the only scientifically proven effective treatment for autism, and it is effective. Now you say, okay, but only slightly less than 50% of the kids recover. Well, what happens to the other 50% of the kids? First of all, I gotta go back and say that when we say that just under 50% fully recover, that means they're not qualified for an autism diagnosis, and they're virtually indistinguishable from their peers. They're not having extra services. They're totally in regular school and do not need any kind of support services. If you're unclear about recovery, I encourage you to watch the video that Dr. Adele Nadowski did that is on this site under the support center. Go to CARD's definition of recovery and learn all about that so that you're 100% clear about exactly what they're talking about. But for the other 50%, right, what happens with them? Because if you're saying, okay, well, 50%, you know, they're the best odds that are out there, but, you know, I want to know that this is time well spent. Well, I'm getting ahead of myself because I'm so excited. In the Lovaas Young Autism Experiment, what you see is that that there were really three groups of kids. There was a group of kids that recovered. I'm visualizing a pie chart because that was always the way it was shown to me. There was the group of kids who were recovered. Then of the other group of kids, there were two separate groups. One group that did really remarkably well and showed a tremendous amount of progress. Maybe they didn't reach the recovered, but they had full lives and really exciting. And then a smaller group of kids that still had progress, but their progress wasn't what it was for the other two groups. And that pretty much is replicated in, as far as I am aware, in the other studies, that if you get roughly 50% of the kids who recover, there's still tremendous progress in the other groups. And I saw a video a while back of some of the kids who were in the Young Lovaas experiment. And what was really striking to me was talking about those kids in the other side of the chart that didn't recover and what had happened for them. And in one case, there was a mom who was talking about her son who was part of the experiment, and he was in the group that had not made the tremendous amount of progress. And, let's face it, everybody wants to be in the tremendous amount of progress or in the recovery group, right? Isn't that, can we all admit that that's where we'd like to end up? But it was really interesting to see this mom talk because she talked about her son and said, you know, when we started in the experiment, my son had no skills at all. And all she did was detail all the things that he could do and all the progress that he had made, which to her was tremendous. And I remember being very humbled by it and thinking, you know, progress is important for all of our kids. And yeah, it's lovely and romantic to talk about where you finish, but the truth of the matter is that we're never finished, and all we can live is in this moment. And what had happened for this child who was in the least desirable group as a parent, through a parent's eyes, this parent was thrilled because her child had made so much progress. He was you know, could communicate functionally, was able to express his feelings, was great with adaptive skills, that, you know, he went to school and he came home and he had chores to do and he set the table, and she had this loving relationship with him, and he was getting ready to graduate from high school and was going to start a job. And she was saying, you know, this would not have been the case had we not done this. And it was just very humbling to me to think, okay, you know, progress is progress wherever you are. But the myth is, because for the many years after the Young autism experiment, people said, oh, well, you know, it wasn't replicated, so it isn't valid. The truth is that it's been replicated many times over. In fact, the Center for Autism and Related Disorders was recently a part of a study that was done in Arizona where it absolutely mirrored the experiment that they took a group of kids. The state of Arizona helped to pay for it to see if, in fact, ABA was really going to be something effective for the children in Arizona. They worked with these kids 25 to 40 hours a week for 2 years, and almost half of them recovered fully. And in the other 50%, tremendous progress, and some kids who made really substantive progress. So, and that's after 2 years. I just have to say that my son, if we had looked at my son at 2 years, he had made tremendous progress. Are you kidding me? My child was talking, he was in neurotypical school, and he was wonderful, but he didn't qualify for a recovered diagnosis. He doesn't still qualify for a recovered diagnosis. But I have people all the time who say they had no idea now if they meet him, you know, and I gotta say that it's a wonderful place to be in, to just be seeing the progress. I don't know where we'll end up, and I won't say that I don't care, but the progress is paramount. And we've seen time and time again, and I said that this is important to you for a lot of different reasons, because you want to use your time effectively, and we see that this is effective with all of the kids. The progress is going to be different based on the child, but progress is possible with all of the kids. It's also going to be important to you legally, because if you're at a school, they have a obligation to provide for you a FAPE, which is free appropriate public education. Appropriate is the big word there. I know it would seem like free would be the big word. It's not. Appropriate is the big word. Because when we know that something is effective, then we can certainly make an argument that that is what is appropriate. So your child has, and this is what we see with insurance reform, what's happening, because we know that ABA is effective, more companies are covering it, which is going to make a difference in your child's life, in your children's lives. So you need to be aware of the studies that are out there and what they demonstrate, and the fact that the Surgeon General has said as well that ABA is the gold standard of treatment for autism. Of course, in the heat of the battle at IEPs with schools, schools will tell you they don't have an obligation to give you the gold standard of treatment. They don't have to give you what is best. They have to give you what is appropriate. And so our argument then becomes, as parents, then what is appropriate can only be what is effective. And if they're offering you something that is not ABA, your question is, can you show me studies where this is effective, what you're offering me? Oh, get ready for that, right? Because they don't like it when you say that. But, you know, at the end of the day, these are our kids and we have to advocate for them. Okay.